Good evening, good evening. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the final concert of the New World Symphonies Festival, Viola Visions. We're so thrilled with the immense variety and excellence of the concerts over this time period. And it's been very reflective for us to think back that the New World Symphony began 32 years ago. And at that time, only two of the pieces that we've played in this week's festival were written. And also at that time, it would have been a challenge to think of the number of phenomenally excellent viola artists worldwide who could have played these pieces. Such is the difference of what has happened in the last 30 years in the whole conception of what the instrument is. And it's been this inspirational combination of incredible artistry on the part of the musicians, the virtuosi who have been redefining the instrument, and also the response of composers of a wide, wide, wide variety of different styles to embracing the possibilities of this wonderful voice in the orchestra. And you're going to hear some very strikingly different examples of that this evening. I also want to thank many people, wonderful artists that we were not able to invite to this festival because it would have had to been at least twice as long or three times as long to respectfully include all the many, many great artists who are out there in chamber ensembles, orchestras, solo players, everything. We're not done with this, so hang with us. It's now my very great pleasure to introduce a fabulous composer, American composer whose music is very, very widely played because of the enormous heart and incredible expertise that she brings to it, who has written this outstanding concerto you're going to hear tonight. And please welcome Jennifer Higdon.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Whoops, wait, is the microphone working? No microphone. Oh, there we go. Now, sometimes that's all it takes. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. A little bit about this viola concerto. It was written for Roberto Díaz, who is about to come out and play it. It was commissioned by the Curtis Institute of Music and the Library of Congress. And I was thinking about the fact that the Library of Congress is such an institution of American, represents everything that's American. They have speeches from every politician and they've got Aaron Copland's music there, and they just have such a deep history. And so I thought to myself, I want my piece to sound very American, which usually happens because I'm an American composer. It happens automatically. But when I was researching viola concertos, because I've written quite a bit for viola, one of the things that struck me was the pieces were always kind of dark. I mean, really dark. They felt like super serious. And there's nothing wrong with serious, but I thought, has any composer attempted to write something that has kind of an up sort of vibe to show the viola side that can do this? We have that in violin concertos, but I feel like we haven't had it in viola concertos. So it was my goal right off the bat to write a piece that kind of moved and had kind of a good feel to it. So this is a three-movement work, and the first movement is very slow and lyrical, shows off the gorgeous tone that I associate with the viola. It's one of the things I just adore about the instrument. The middle movement, it kind of moves at a real clip. It has kind of a light scherzo sort of feel to it. And the third movement is a combination of slow music and fast with kind of, it's almost like a jazz sort of rhythm, but it sounds very American to me. I wanted to start that movement with a little motive that the viola does that I wrote. My very first sonata was for viola, so I actually took a little part of that and buried it in the piece. So it was just so much fun to write. And this is a concerto that's a little different than some in that the orchestra does, I think, just about as much as the soloist, which the orchestra probably says, uh-huh, that's true. But I wanted to give a chamber feel also to this. So at various points, you will hear the violist actually playing with individual soloists. And this, because the players are so good now, we can do that. They're better than they've ever been at any point in time in history. And as a composer, it's just heaven to be able to really utilize that, build something. Not only a soloist that can do a lot of stuff, but also within the orchestra. Thank you for sharing your time with us. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, please silence your cell phone. Thank you.
Damas y caballeros, les recordamos que por favor pongan en modo silencioso sus teléfonos celulares. Muchas gracias.
Let me say a few words about Morton Feldman. He was one of the wittiest, most sparkling people that I've ever known, and yet his music inhabits a luminously mournful world, very much related to the painters with whom he was so well acquainted and who mutually inspired him, particularly Mark Rothko, Robert Rauschenberg, and de Kooning. I think if you could imagine being able to be inside one of those paintings, as if the painting were surrounding you, and you were able to wander through it and observe the different markings and squiggles and washes of color and see them from different perspectives. That would be something like what Feldman is doing in these pieces. In this way, he shared something in common with his very great friend, the Japanese composer Toru Takemitsu. And Takemitsu wrote a number of pieces which were based on the experience of wandering through a Zen garden and seeing the same rock, waterfall, cypress tree from different angles and different perspectives as you wander through it. This is very much this beautiful wander that is Morty's music. And in fact, he sort of told me about this when I was first beginning to perform his music. So many of these pieces were written in the early 1970s. A whole stream of amazing pieces began at that point, which is also around the time that I first got to know him. And the music on the page is very intricate. Every bar is another meter, 3, 4, 5, 2, 17, 16, and so on. Yet he says that it should be performed in a floating way without any sense of a beat. And he once said to me, listen, because he spoke with a very thick Brooklyn accent, and he said, if you want to understand my music, you ought to come over to my house and watch me compose sometime. Come over, you really ought to see it. It's an experience. And I did go over to his house, and he kind of sat there at the, he had the piano. He also had this big table with many, many, many lines of music he wrote. He said, let's see, where was I yesterday? Oh, yes, this chord, multi-divisi, high harmonics, contrabasses mixed with a couple of flutes. How did that go? Oh, yes. That's how it went. Let's see, I'm wondering what's going to come next. Then it comes to me, Glockenspiel, high F sharp, 3/8 bar. Then what's gonna come next? I'm not sure, so I'll put a bar rest. Then it comes to me, tremolo, you know, ponticello, low, 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 something. And this was the experience in which he invited us all to be a part. The notes, they're very much like Duke Ellington or Anton Webern, or really haunting notes. And You'll hear in the piece a lot of motives, recurring motives. Sometimes they can just be one note, like the note just repeated. Sometimes there are a little bit longer chains of notes, like perhaps remembered artifacts of some melody from way back in your past. And then there is one really very beautiful melody, which occurs 5 times in the piece, each time slightly different and surrounded by this wonderful wash of colors and textures. And it's an amazing thing for a composer to be able to look so directly into the nature of this kind of beauteous loneliness. It's a very special inspiration. And it was a great honor of my life to know him, play this many of his pieces for him, premiere some of his pieces, and he would have been thrilled to hear the very beauteous playing brought to his piece this evening by the wonderful Cynthia Phelps. Please welcome Cynthia.
Thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, please silence your cell phone. Thank you.
Damas y caballeros, les recordamos que por favor pongan en modo silencioso sus teléfonos celulares. Muchas gracias.
One of the absolute mainstays of the viola and orchestra repertoire is Berlioz's incredible piece, Harold in Italy, which was a collaboration, meant to be a very close collaboration between Berlioz and Paganini, two of the absolutely wildest people who were ever on the musical scene. Somehow or another, this collaboration didn't really work out so comfortably, and in the end, Berlioz just proceeded writing a piece which was perhaps considerably more introspective than what Paganini had in mind. But in doing this piece over 30 or 40 years with great violists, I've always felt there was this something missing of like what the piece might have been if that collaboration had worked well and Berlioz had decided to write some of the music that Paganini also wrote for viola, very, very virtuoso, unusual music. And I had this dream of sort of what would be Harold's further adventures in Italy, in which the violas would be more of a protagonist. I thought, who could possibly make such an extravagant and wild and intricate vision happen? And I thought, ah, Steven Mackey. Steve Mackey, of course, could do it with his background as a electric guitar player and the fabulously inventive way he writes for instruments and also the kind of mercurial and a wild spirit that he really shares with Berlioz. So I asked him to do it, and he very generously consented. And here's what he has to say about it. Welcome, Steven Mackey.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Well, like Michael, 40 years ago or so, encountering this piece, it knocked me out. And it's, you know, so vivid. But I also wondered, what's the viola doing at the end? I've seen performances where the viola just sits down in the last movement and gives up. And I think there may have even been a group of drunken composers in grad school sitting around and said, yeah, somebody should write some music for the viola to play in the last movement. But nobody took that far. And that's the difference between MTT and the rest of us, is he has an idea and he does it. And I've encountered this many other times. And I should have learned my lesson. When he asked me, I said, sure, Michael, yeah, let's do that. But I didn't. I thought that'd be the end of it. But no, here we are. It turned out to be a really fun and exciting but very challenging project because Berlioz, of all people, Berlioz the iconoclast, was not a polite do-gooder that followed all the rules of harmony and form that of his contemporaries. He was a firebrand. So when I first started, I had respect, but I was like a visitor in his house. I was being very polite, and he had all this crazy furniture, but I was just afraid to touch anything. And Michael really helped. I'd send him iteration after iteration, and he'd say things like, the viola needs to jump out and say, "En garde!" Okay. And after many, many iterations, I really started to feel like I was composing, not like I was a musicologist reconstructing something, but that I was actually composing, and that this was now my house. And I think I owe a lot of that to Michael. There were a few iterations way down the line that we pulled back from, where he thought, "Okay, now you're just messing up his furniture. You're just now you're going too far." But I'm happily using that material for the piece that I'm working on now. So,
excellent.
Yeah,
I think music historians of the future will really appreciate reading our emails.
I was thinking that. Yeah, absolutely. So, I hope you know where Berlioz ends and I begin. But if not, you can ask me afterwards.
And also, it's a wonderful occasion for us to welcome Tabea Zimmermann, who's never worked with the orchestra before, and she and I have also never worked together, so this is a total pleasure for all these confluences. Yeah. And we'll be right back.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.